Good evening. We come tonight to lift up the name of Jesus, to celebrate the sacrifice that he made for us on Calvary. For if it had not been for the Lord who was on our side, if it had not been that God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that we might have a chance to eternal life, let us pray. Most gracious and most heavenly Father, Lord God, we just come to say thank you on tonight. Oh God, we know that what you went through for our sins, oh God, had to be done. For you, oh Lord, were the only perfect sacrifice. Oh God, the lambs and the sheep couldn't do it. So we just want to say thank you. Oh God, that you came down from glory, hallelujah, to die on an old rugged cross, that we would one day be able to lift you up, to praise you, to magnify and to glorify you. Oh God, so we just want to bless your name, God. You said in your word that if you be lifted up, that you would draw all men unto you. So God, we just want to lift you up. Oh God, we just want to let the world know, oh God, that they can come running saying, what must I do to be saved? So God, as we gather tonight on this Good Friday, oh God, we pray that you would bless right now, oh God. We pray that you would keep us, oh God. Oh God, that in this production, oh God, that we would glorify and magnify you. We ask all these things in the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen. Good evening again. We are about to go on a journey. This journey will be like no other journey that you've ever experienced before. This evening, we will follow in the footsteps of Jesus and witness what happened during Holy Week. Holy Week is a time of great importance for Christians as it commemorates the final week of Jesus Christ's life on earth. Each day of Holy Week holds a special meaning for Christians. The lives that were changed during this week when Jesus crossed their paths. I'm sure that each person had a different story to tell because no one's life is the same when Jesus crosses your path. Understanding the significance of each day in Holy Week deepens our appreciation of the sacrifice that was made for our salvation. We are thankful and grateful tonight that one day, while we were yet sinners, Jesus crossed our path and changed our lives forevermore. Tonight, the arts and music ministries present to you Our Paths Have Crossed. Amen.
On the Sunday before his death, Jesus began his trip to Jerusalem, knowing that soon he would lay down his life for our sins. A great multitude that had come to the feast when they heard that Jesus was coming to Jerusalem took branches of palm trees and went out to meet him and cried out, "Hosanna! Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord, the King of Israel." Then Jesus, when he had found a donkey, sat on it, as it is written, "Fear not, daughter of Zion. Behold, your king is coming, sitting on a donkey's colt." A colt that had not been used was considered holy by the Jews and was fit to carry a king. A sign of homage and recognition of Jesus' kingship. Then Jesus slowly, humbly, made his triumphal entry into Jerusalem. When he entered Jerusalem, all of the city was trembling with excitement, saying, "Who is this?" And the crowds were saying, This is the prophet Jesus from Nazareth in Galilee. On Palm Sunday, Jesus and his disciples spent the night in Bethany, a town about 2 miles east of Jerusalem.
just for me. I'm so glad you did it for me. Catch me when I slip, Lord, I'm glad.
On Monday morning, Jesus and his disciples head back to Jerusalem. Along the way, Jesus was hungry. Seeing a lone fig tree at the roadside, he went to it and found nothing but leaves on it and said to it, "Never again fruit come from you." And at once the fig tree withered. Jesus and the disciples continued into Jerusalem. When Jesus entered the temple grounds, he drove out with force all who were buying and selling birds and animals for sacrifice in the temple area. Jesus turned over the tables of the corrupt money changers, who made a profit exchanging foreign money for temple coinage, and the chairs of those who were selling doves for sacrifice. Jesus said to them, "It is written in the scriptures, 'My house shall be called a house of prayer,' but you are making it a robber's den." The chief priests, scribes, and elders questioned Jesus' authority. On Monday evening, Jesus stayed in Bethany again, probably in the home of his friends Mary, Martha, and Lazarus.
Two.
On Tuesday morning, Jesus and his disciples returned to Jerusalem. They passed a withered fig tree on their way, and Jesus spoke to his companions about the importance of faith. Back at the temple, religious leaders were upset at Jesus for establishing himself as a spiritual authority. They organized an ambush with the intent to place him under arrest. But Jesus evaded their traps and pronounced harsh judgment on them. Jesus left the city and went with his disciples to the Mount of Olives, where Jesus spoke in parables of the two sons and the landowner to his disciples. Tuesday was also the day Judas Iscariot negotiated with the Sanhedrin to betray Jesus. After a tiring day of confrontation and warnings about the future, once again, Jesus and the disciples returned to Bethany to stay the night. On Thursday, Jesus and his disciples prepare for the Passover and the Lord's Supper, which is now known as Maundy Thursday. From Bethany, Jesus sent Peter and John ahead to the upper room in Jerusalem to make the preparations for the Passover feast. When the hour had come, he sat down and the 12 apostles with him. Then he said to them, "With fervent desire, I have desired to eat this Passover with you before I suffer. For I say to you, I will no longer eat of it until it is fulfilled in the kingdom of God." Then he took the cup and gave thanks and said, "Take this and divide it among yourselves, for I say to you, I will not drink of the fruit of the vine until the kingdom of God comes." And he took bread and gave thanks and broke it and gave it to them, saying, "This is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, after the supper, he took the cup, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, which is poured out for you. But the hand of him who is going to betray me is with mine on the table. The Son of Man will go as it has been decreed, but woe to that man who betrays him." They began to question among themselves which of them it might be who would do this. And supper being ended, the devil having already put into the heart of Judas Iscariot, Simon's son, to betray him, Jesus, knowing that the Father had given all things into his hands, and that he had come from God and was going to God, rose from supper and laid aside his garments, took a towel, and girded himself. Then he poured water into the basin and began washing the disciples' feet and wiping them with the towel which was tied around his waist. When he came to Simon Peter, he said to him, "Lord, are you going to wash my feet?" Jesus replied to him, "You do not realize now what I am doing, but you will fully understand it later." Peter said to him, "You will never wash my feet." Jesus answered, "Unless I wash you, you have no part of me." We can have nothing to do with each other. Simon Peter said to him, Lord, in that case, wash not only my feet, but also my hands and my head. Jesus said to him, anyone who has bathed needs only to wash his feet and completely clean. And you, my disciples, are clean, but not all of you. For he knew he was going to betray him. For that reason, said, not all of you are clean. Later, Jesus and the disciples left the upper room. Then Jesus came with them to a place called Gethsemane, and he told his disciples, sit here while I go over there and pray. And taking with him Peter and the two sons of Zebedee, James and John, he began to be grieved and greatly distressed. Then he said to them, my soul is deeply grieved, so that I am almost dying of sorrow. Stay here and stay awake and keep watch with me. And after going a little farther, he fell face down and prayed, saying, my Father, if it is possible, that is consistent with your will, let this cup pass from me. Yet, not as I will, but as you will. And he came to the disciples and found them sleeping. Jesus said to Peter, so, you men could not stay awake and keep watch with me for 1 hour? Keep actively watching and praying that you may not come into temptation. The spirit is willing, but the body is weak. He went away a second time and prayed, saying, my Father, if this cannot pass away until I drink it, your will be done. Again he came and found them sleeping, for their eyes were heavy. So leaving them again, he went away and prayed for the third time, saying the same words once more. Then he returned to the disciples and said to them, are you still sleeping and resting? Listen, the hour of my sacrifice is at hand. And the Son of Man is being betrayed into the hands of sinners, whose way and nature is to oppose God. Get up, let us go. Look, my betrayer is near. Jesus, therefore, knowing all things that would come upon him, went forward and said to them, whom are you seeking? They answered him, Jesus of Nazareth. Jesus said to them, I am he. And Judas, who betrayed him and also stood with them, then he asked them again, whom are you seeking? And they said, Jesus of Nazareth. Jesus answered, I have told you that I am he. Therefore, if you seek me, let these go their way, that the saying might be fulfilled which he spoke. Of those whom you gave me, I have lost none. Peter pulls the sword out of his holster and cuts off the soldier's ear. So Jesus said to Peter, put your sword into the sheath. Shall I not drink the cup which my Father has given me? Jesus was taken to the home of Caiaphas, the high priest, where the whole council had gathered to begin making their case against Jesus. Meanwhile, in the early morning hours, as Jesus' trial was getting underway, Peter denied knowing the master three times before the rooster crowed. Good Friday is the most difficult day of Passion Week. Christ's journey turned treacherous and acutely painful in these final hours leading to his death. According to scripture, Judas Iscariot, the disciple who had betrayed Jesus, was overcome with remorse and hanged himself early Friday morning. Meanwhile, before the third hour, Jesus endured the shame of false accusations, condemnation, mockery, beatings, and abandonment. After multiple unlawful trials, he was sentenced to death by crucifixion, one of the most horrible and disgraceful methods of capital punishment known at the time.
Were you there?
Before Christ was led away, soldiers spit on him and tormented and mocked him and pierced him with a crown of thorns. Then Jesus carried his own cross to Calvary. Now, as they came out, they found a man of Cyrene, Simon by name, him that compelled to bear his cross. And when they had come to a place called Golgotha, that is to say, place of a skull, he was mocked and insulted as Roman soldiers nailed him to the wooden cross. They gave him sour wine mingled with gall to drink, but when he had tasted it, he would not drink. Then they crucified him, divided his garments, casting lots, that it might be fulfilled which was spoken by the prophet. There were also two other criminals led with him to be put to death. And when they had come to the place called Calvary, there they crucified him, and the criminals, one on the right hand and the other on the left. Then Jesus said, "Father, forgive them, for they do not know what they do." Then one of the criminals who were hanged blasphemed him, saying, "If you are the Christ, save yourself and us." But the other, answering, rebuked him, saying, "Do you not even fear God, seeing you are under the same condemnation? And we indeed justly, for we receive the due reward for our deeds. But this man has done nothing wrong." Then he said to Jesus, "Lord, remember me when you come into your kingdom." And Jesus said to him, "Assuredly, I say to you, today you will be with me in paradise." Now there stood by the cross of Jesus his mother and his mother's sister Mary, the wife of Clopas, and Mary Magdalene. When Jesus therefore saw his mother and the disciple whom he had loved standing by, he said to his mother, "Woman, behold your son." Then he said to the disciple, "Behold your mother." And from that hour, his own home. Now, when the sixth hour had come, there was darkness over the whole land until the ninth hour. And at the ninth hour, Jesus cried out with a loud voice, saying, "Eli, Eli, lama sabachthani," which is translated, my God, why have you forsaken me?" After this, Jesus, knowing that all things were now accomplished, that the scripture might be fulfilled, said, "I thirst." So when Jesus received the sour wine, he said, "It is finished." Now it was about the sixth hour, and there was darkness all over the earth until the ninth hour. Then the sun darkened, and the veil of the temple was torn in two. And when Jesus had cried out with a loud voice, he said, "Father, into your hands I commit my spirit." Having said this, he breathed his last breath. By 6 p.m. Friday evening, they took Jesus' body down from the cross and laid it in a borrowed tomb. Jesus' body lay in his tomb, where it was guarded by Roman soldiers throughout the day on Saturday, which was the Sabbath. When the Sabbath ended at 6 p.m., Jesus' body was ceremonially treated for burial with spices purchased by Nicodemus. While his physical body lay in the tomb, Jesus Christ paid the penalty for sin by offering the perfect, spotless sacrifice. He conquered death, both spiritually and physically, securing our eternal salvation.
Everybody sing
glory to the Lamb.
Glory,
glory
to the Lamb.
Resurrection Sunday, we reach the culmination of Holy Week. The resurrection of Jesus Christ is the most important event of the Christian faith. Now, after the Sabbath, as the first day of the week began to dawn, Mary Magdalene, Mary, the mother of James, and Joanna came to see the tomb. And behold, there was a great earthquake, for an angel of the Lord descended from heaven and rolled back the stone from the door and sat on it. His countenance was like lightning, and his clothing as white as snow. And the guards shook for fear of him and became like dead men. But the angel answered and said to the women, "Do not be afraid, for I know what you seek, Jesus who was crucified. He is not here, for he is risen. As he said, come see the place where the Lord lay. And go quickly and tell his disciples that he is risen from the dead. And indeed, he is going before you into Galilee. There you will see him. Behold, I have told you." So they went out quickly from the tomb with fear and great joy and ran to bring his disciples word. On the day of his resurrection, Jesus Christ made at least five appearances. The first person to see him was Mary Magdalene. Jesus also appeared to Peter, to the two disciples on the road to Emmaus, and later that day to all of the disciples except Thomas, while they were gathered in a house for prayer. The Bible clearly states that after his resurrection, Jesus repeatedly answered to his disciples over a period of 40 days. And being assembled together with them, he commanded them not to depart from Jerusalem, but to wait for the promise of the Father, which he said, "You have heard from me, for John truly baptized with water, but you shall be baptized with the Holy Spirit not many days from now. And you shall receive power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you, and you shall be witnesses to me in Jerusalem and in all Judea and Samaria and to the end of the earth." Now, when he had spoken these things, while they watched, he was taken up, and a cloud received him out of their sight.
praise the Lord. Hallelujah.
Yeah.
We're going to ask our pastor to come at this time. Give her a round of applause as she comes. Amen. Yeah. This was part of her vision. So we thank and praise God for her on tonight. Amen. Love you.
Amen. Don't go too far, Elder Hill. Can we give the Lord a hand clap of praise tonight? Hallelujah on this Good Friday. Come on, we can do better than that. Come on, we know that he died a death for all of us, that we would have a right to the tree of eternal life. And we're grateful on tonight. My heart is full. I wept quite a few times during the presentation. Sometimes we can read the text and sometimes it's easy for us to disconnect. But tonight I'm grateful that we had a hands-on demonstration of just a glimpse of what it must have been like for Jesus to go through what he did, the entire experience, lost for words, but tonight I am. But it's a good place, and I'm just thankful and full for what our eyes have seen and what our ears have heard on tonight. Janice Hill, hallelujah. The leader of our arts ministry, we bless the Lord for you. To Elder George Floyd and our amazing music ministry, we thank God for all of them. And she is right. This year I called them in and I said, the Lord has given me a vision. Our paths have crossed. Y'all have heard it the whole month long. And we wanted to be intentional this year about making sure that this resurrection weekend was about reaching those that were unchurched and those that do not know the Lord Jesus Christ and the pardon of their sins. And so tonight was part one of that. And we mentioned to all of the disciples and the crowd and the wailing women, thank God for them. To our praise dancers, our vessels of praise, bless the Lord for them. We also thank God for our set managers. They were working hard. Those that are in media, those that are working the lights. Hallelujah. Thank God for all of you. And I want to commend, I didn't know he had it in him, but I want to commend Deacon Joseph Thomas on tonight for playing the role of Jesus. Did such an amazing job. We thank God. When they came to get you out the garden, the disciples wasn't bucking enough for me. I was like, no. I was ready for somebody to jump. It was hard for me for real to contain. Just don't realize the depth and the magnitude of God sending his only begotten son into this evil world to die for all of our sins, that one day we would choose him, that it would be destined for us to do so, that when we take our last breaths in these mortal bodies, that we would be able to lift up our eyes unto the hills, look him in his eye face to face, and hear the words, well done, our good and faithful servant. Heaven is still the goal. That is what we are striving for, not for form or fashion, but to one day literally make it in, to meet the man named Jesus that we sing about, to meet the man named Jesus that we preach and we teach about all the time. One day it's going to happen, and it's going to be a personal account that all of us have to take, an individual journey. And so tonight, I don't want to miss this opportunity to offer Jesus Christ. If there be anyone in the building on tonight, after being moved by such an amazing production through our Ministry of Arts and Music Ministry, and you're saying tonight, Pastor, I want to choose him. I want him to be Lord over my life. Will you come? I promise you it's the best decision that you could ever make in your life to say yes to Jesus. Will we have one that will come? Hallelujah. Oh, glory to his name. Bless you, my sister. Hang out right here for a second. Will there be another? See, sometimes we don't know what we do and the impact that it's going to make and how we got to be out of the box to make sure we're reaching those that God has called us to in this season. Oh, I feel the shift in the room. God, have your way. Oh, bless your name, Jesus. Will there be another that says, I want to secure my spot in heaven? Will there be another? There may be someone in the room tonight that says, I want to rededicate my life and live a life upright and holy toward him. Glory. Hallelujah. Oh, we got a grand opportunity in front of us now to give the Lord another yes. I don't care if you've been saved 30 or 40 years. Sometimes there comes a turning point in our faith where we know we need to say yes again. Will there be another? My dear sister, for you coming to him for the first time, correct? Rededicating your life. Hallelujah. Glory be to God. Already. Hallelujah for both of you. I want to pray on tonight before we leave, if that's all right. Amen. Father in heaven, we thank you for these, God, your children that have come down, your daughters that have come down to your altar. Father, we don't take for granted this moment, but God, we glorify and we magnify your name because you've been so good to us. Father, we thank you, God, that by the Holy Spirit, you unction their hearts to move on tonight. Father, I pray, oh God, that you would grant them the very desires of their heart. Father, that you would remove stumbling blocks and struggles, God, things that have been in the way from being as close to you as they desire. But tonight, along with me and all these hosts of great saints and believers, oh God, we rejoice in the name of Jesus. For those that have come back, Father, we thank you that when we turn to come back to you, that your arms are wide open. You don't even ask us any questions, but with grace, you open your arms to your daughters that are at your altar on tonight. Father, I thank you. God, I pray tonight that you would strengthen the inner man. God, that they would be able to stay, God, on your battlefield. God, that they would take the horns of the altar, God, and begin to call out on your name like never before. So we remove guilt and shame on tonight. Father, we release the peace that your word talks about that surpasses all understanding. God, we glorify you. We magnify you. And Father, we'll forever be grateful for your kindness and your hand of mercy. Father, I thank you that you stayed the hand of death over these women, God, to allow them to have this opportunity to say yes one more time. Because you are so gracious to us and so forgiving, we can't help but to lift your name up, to glorify your name on tonight, God, because you're a good God and you're worthy to be praised. Father, I pray, God, that you would encamp your angels around them, that you would let them know that the altar is a safe place. This is a place where we come for restoration, a place where we come to have a right relationship with you. Father, I pray that they will forever thirst and hunger after righteousness. God, that they will seek you all the days of their lives. And it is in the name of Jesus we pray. Come on, saints of God, can we celebrate tonight? Hallelujah. 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 Lord, we bless you. And God, we thank you. And we magnify your precious name. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. 68 years old on today. Let's thank God for life, health, and strength. Hallelujah. Again, if there won't be anything else at this time, I'm going to turn it back over to Elder Janice Hill at this time. Thank God again for her and her amazing team.
praise God for a pastor with a vision. Amen. And we know that God gives the vision to the head of the house. So we thank her for the vision that God has given her. We thank God for each one of you that came out on tonight. I would like everybody that participated, praise dance, disciples, Jesus, to come up, and we're going to get a photograph before you leave. But we're standing all over the building. Lord, we just thank you once again for your grace, for your mercies. Thank you for your sacrifices, God. And Lord, as we prepare to leave this place, we thank you that we never leave your presence. So we ask that you would go with us, oh God, as we travel the highways and the byways. Lord, we pray that we find our homes as we left them. Oh God, we thank you, God, for being such a good God that is concerned about everything that concerns us. So as we leave this place, oh God, we commit ourselves again to you. And we ask all these things in the name of Jesus, we pray. And we still believe that if you do it right,